Yeah, thank you, Garage, first of all, for the invitation, and to everybody at Garage for helping. Thanks to the speakers as well, to the other speakers. I've really enjoyed the past couple of days, and I've learned a lot. And thank you to the embassy as well for your help. Now, speaking as somebody who uses and experiences archives rather than as an archive expert, I'll begin this proposal or attempt with an anecdote. Some years ago, I pursued a postdoc in art history, and as a result of my making overtures to an English research institution, I had a phone conversation with a professor who tested my mettle. The professor weighed my motives for pursuing an academic career. It's not very lucrative, I was told. And we discussed what in academic parlance is called project design. In particular, I remember being told that I should go and find that untapped archive that could make the cornerstone of my research. Now, years after this conversation took place, I'm still trying to make sense of what it means to speak of the archive in this way. You can choose to see the professor's remark as symptomatic of instituted prejudice. To think of the archive as a tapped or untapped entity suggests that it's a passive resource to be discovered, a kind of battery for art history. It turns the archive into a virgin body or a blank spot on the map. The untapped archive is an other that is rich in content, but mute and without legitimate representation, a colony, in other words. The implications of tapped and untapped build on binaries of subject and object, origin and mediator, before and after. It also outlines an infernal alternative. If you don't tap this or that archive, somebody else will. So we must resign to the fact of competition, which is surely not a good idea when we are dealing with public memory or with other of the Enlightenment ideals that are related to the archive. And of course, we can imagine the archive in other terms than tapped or untapped, and we should do so for the sake of our understanding of the encounters we have with archives. In an attempt to think through the middle, penser par le milieu, as Gilles Deleuze had it, the archive can be spatialized and temporalized in terms of what could be called an archival ecology. In an ecology, subjects and objects leak into each other in states of codependency. Taken in this sense, ecology has become a popular noun among theorists to qualify types of symbiosis beyond the world of biology proper. They talk about ecologies of fear, ecologies of knowledge, political ecologies. If we choose to see the archive as a kind of political ecology, we must keep in mind what the anthropologists Deborah Adanovsky and Eduardo Viveiros de Castro remind us, namely that the notion of a political ecology is a redundant combination of terms. No ecology was ever untouched by the social, nor was it ever devoid of politics. This is crucial to how we represent archives and how we imagine the history that archives on their side represent. Perhaps an archival ecology can help us think of the real alternatives provided by archival encounters. My image for this is the protagonist of Stanislaw Lem's novel Solaris, famously adapted to film by Andrei Tarkovsky. This protagonist is an intelligent ocean that produces spectral visitors. As uncanny embodiments of personal trauma, the visitors are wish fulfillments as much as nightmares to a small group of scientists stationed on the planet Solaris. Like the interplanetary travelers to Solaris, I think the archive is a place we must go. Now, Solaris makes for a strange panorama. As a counterintuitive figure for the not-so-human age of cultural memory, the ocean on Solaris would represent the live, reproductive capacities of the archive. It becomes an emergent entity with which we can develop relations of futurity against the present order of meaning. If the notion of an untapped archive calls up the mental image of bottled time or time to be labeled and decanted, The archive, understood as an intelligent ocean, offers the chance for purposeful immersion. This would turn the archive into a temporal entity that awaits the next interpretation. The next interpretation that is haunted by many meanings that maybe or maybe not can be put to rest. The archive as a site for revelations and resurrections, perhaps, as the scientists on Solaris say of their non-human visitors. The conception of the archive, this conception of the archive would be incapable of reaching the symbolic terminus implied by the metaphor of tapping the archive. Every new reading of an archive places us before it, temporally speaking. I think this is what was yesterday referred to by Ladislav as potential lying in the past. Besides, some things must be commemorated before they take place. After, it's too late. So like ghosts, archives come back from the future to find somebody to talk to. In this encounter, it's not only the archive that's under scrutiny. Also, the researcher and the theoretical activity that she represents is probed and tested by the archive. As the human protagonist, Chris Kelvin in Solaris, says about the mimetic magma of the Solarian ocean, it materializes thoughts, whether they are made up or from the past. In this way, Solaris reverses the metaphor of the untapped archive. Now it's the researchers who are tapped for their memories and their hidden libidinal investments. And they're given a perverse kind of home on Solaris. Maybe such a negativity is required for the political experience of a totality. In her book, Ghostly Matters, written 20 years ago in 97, the sociologist Avery Gordon writes that, quote, following the ghosts is about making a contact that changes you and refashions the social relations in which you're located, unquote. In her writing on what she calls the sociological imagination, she enlists ghosts in order to make the fictional, the theoretical, and the factual speak to one another. In this, she relies on fiction, on literature, because there is, quote, a whole realm of experiences and social practices that can barely be approached without a method attentive to what is elusive, fantastic, contingent, and often barely there in real life, unquote. I should also confess that the idea of searching for untapped archives struck me because I, in a sense, could be accused of having done so in my work as a curator and art historian. I would conceptualize what I do differently than that, of course, but I am often working in the margins of art history with artists whose work has had little or no reception and for one reason or other has been forgotten or is deemed illegible. This typically concerns what you could call irritable forms of art that are co-constituted with other forms of cultural thinking and acting, and in this way concerns both individual and collective perceptions. An example of this would be the work of Inspection Medical Hermeneutics, and I'm sure and I hope that many of you are familiar with this practice. It's an artist group formed in Moscow in 1987 by Sergei Anufriev, Yuri Leiderman, sorry, and Pavel Pepperstein, a group that existed until 1994. Together they made installations and performances that investigated Russian culture at the time of Glasnost. And they described Glasnost as a moment when the sky opened up, akin to not enlightenment exactly, but a psychedelic experience, they called it. When a rupture between systems brings anxiety as well as the promise of renewal. Their work was a theory of escape, you could say, a dissolution and a blurring of cultural signs and systems based on the assumption that knowledge is always already a collective phenomenon. In Pepperstein's words, Inspection Medical Hermeneutics produced, quote, a thick mumble, white noise, and other incomprehensible, unclear things. Their practice was based on conversations recorded on tape, And in one instance from 1990, the conversations are described in this way, quote, "We always chat about some kind of concrete, already over-reflected thing and the traces of forthcoming mental application. That is, we find ourselves at the point of stretching meaning as such in a constant in-between," unquote. So these speech acts that the hermeneutics engaged in, this stretching meaning made for inspections and diagnosis of the organization of knowledge. The title of the installation here, Amber Room, from 1991, refers to the legend of Tsarina Catherine II's hiding place from enemies, an amber room. The smiling faces on the balloons depict a shape-shifting character from a folktale, Kolobok, I'm sure you're familiar with, a character who's always running away. So to be like Kolobok for the hermeneutics stands for a specific attitude of artists who have a penchant for slipping away when aggressive interpretation sets in. And the framed photos of icons here, together with cushions, resemble domestic Orthodox shrines. The icons have been recorded sideways instead of frontally, thus demonstrating perspective, a Western invention which is usually denied in Orthodox representations. And I should add that this installation shot is from an exhibition that I co-curated in London at an art center called Raven Row in 2010. Now, maybe we can, continue our speculation and borrow from the hermeneutics to add to the imagination of the archive. The archive is an intelligent ocean. The archive is Kolobok that slips away when aggressive interpretation sets in. However, if looking for untapped archives isn't on, how do we deal with marginal archives of art history? How can you carry out the imperative work of recovering artistic work that is at risk of being lost? How can you do so without being guilty of instrumentalizing the archive? This concerns the homelessness of archives, how institutions can be reluctant to acquire archives because archives are costly to organize and operate and unspectacular to boost. Archives are rarely useful in the culture industry. The culture industry as the place where the imagination goes to the dogs, as Adorno and Horkheimer put it. As it has been wonderfully shown by the example of Garage, I believe it's crucial that curators and art institutions think with the archive as much as with the individual artwork. An archive is only being tapped when archival content or historical references are not acknowledged. Now, missed this one. A part of Amber Room had to be recreated for this 2010 showing. So they redid the papier-mâché apples and drew Kolobok faces on them. Yes, Anufriev in his pyjama. Now, I know of inspection medical hermeneutics because of informal oral history. Namely, thanks to artist friends from Copenhagen who introduced me to them. Concern was a Danish artist group that existed between 89 and 93, so the same time span as the hermeneutics. Its members, Jørgen Mikkelsen, Søren Andreasen, Jan Beklund, and Jakob Jakobsen, acknowledged that they probably couldn't have existed without the example of inspection medical hermeneutics. So they can be seen as a kind of Danish copy group of the hermeneutics. Now, inspection medical hermeneutics describe their collective mentality as not as an evolution, quote, but as a form of illness, something that should be cured in their kind of cultural therapy, unquote. So if the hermeneutics were an illness, then Concern in Copenhagen got infected. Concern was also a language-generating group that exacerbated conceptualism into a position that was neither sober nor oriented towards transparency, but instead polemicized the art concept and its cultural connections. Among other activities, the group published a magazine solely dedicated to their own text. And their collective writings were produced as in a kind of exquisite corpse procedure in which the members took turns to edit and rewrite each other's texts. Text rubbing, they called it, sort of frottage. It was a method with its own symbolic violence and potential for conflict among the members of the group, at the same time as it was a way for them to educate and school each other. I think to quote the work that you showed, David, earlier by In the Week of Cooperative Suffering, I think that kind of describes what the methodology of Concern was about. Now, the archive of Concern is one of these homeless archives. It's sort of the archive is spread out between the four members of the group, the four former members of the group. But until the archive of Concern hopefully finds a home in an art institution at some point, we can maybe take comfort in the idea that across history and across cultures, inspection, medical hermeneutics, and Concern take part in creating and recreating each other, as if Concern was one of the doubles produced by the ocean on Solaris. Finally, by way of conclusion, Deleuze, Guattari, define science fiction as a kind of text that works at the border, separating knowledge from ignorance and transforms the one into the other. Separating knowledge from ignorance, but also transforms ignorance into knowledge and vice versa. I would say this also applies to the archive and the challenges to knowledge that it represents. This has also been mentioned over the last couple of days. Dramatizing the archive through sci-fi, we can see the archive as a reminder of our ignorance and of the fact that historical knowledge can instruct our own time that it is not exceptional. If the archive is a dormant space, it dreams, and it dreams of moving and unfixing our contemporaneity. Thank you.